This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to Sunday Evening with the Pastor. We're grateful to God that you joined us tonight as we gather this sanctuary, Bethlehem Baptist Church, the House of Bread, to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We serve an awesome, mighty, powerful God. So I pray tonight, as you worship, you might find yourself giving God praise as we offer him our deep and genuine thanks for all of his blessings. Let us pray. Gracious and glorious God, we, thy people, assemble in this house of worship on this Sunday evening. We gather, O God, to hear from you through your word. We pray, O God, you bless the servant of God who bring the word tonight. O God, we pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would anoint this service afresh, that when we leave from this service, we'll leave better, stronger, wiser, because we've had a time to be with you, and surely you have been with us. In the wonderful, marvelous, incredible name of Jesus Christ, do we pray. Amen. Once again, we thank you for allowing us to come into your home. We've gathered tonight simply to give God praise. And we begin tonight by hearing the word of God. We're blessed to have Dr. Jennifer Jones, Dr. Jennifer Stewart, who'll be sharing with us as a student at Palmer Seminary. We're grateful that God has sent her this way and pray that we will all receive her in the spirit of Christ. So let us now hear the word of God from this woman of God.
The scripture reading will be from John chapter 12, verses 24 and 25. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. This is the word of the Lord.
We're so grateful to God for how God is blessing us during this difficult time. As we deal with the coronavirus, we have sought to honor God in every way humanly possible, that we will continue to have these virtual services, that God will get the glory. And so we have put together Sunday Evening with the Pastor, a wonderful opportunity for us to come together on a Sunday evening, spend quiet time with God. We also have moved to have fireside chat every Thursday from 12 to 1 p.m. We'd invite you to invite your family and friends to join us as we share together the word of God. On this Thursday, we'll be blessed to have the executive director of Interfaith Housing Alliance on October the 1st as she comes and shares with us the plight of homelessness in Montgomery County. We have been serving families in this nature for over 25 years. These families have been housed here at Bethlehem during the month of October. So once again, this October, we will share with the Jarrettown United Methodist Church, as those families that we host will spend the time there. We're grateful for that partnership and pray that the families there will be blessed. We will find the opportunity to see them and to bless them with meals. Our deaconess ministry and deaconess ministry have worked hard so that we could accommodate these families. These are God's people and they are our people, and we want to be supportive of them. At the same time, we invite you to share with us as we will celebrate our 132nd years here at Bethlehem Baptist Church. the fourth Sunday in October, we will gather together to give God praise for 132 years. Bethlehem, the house of bread. My pastor, Reverend Dr. Albert Franklin Campbell, pastor emeritus of the Mount Carmel Baptist Church, will bring the word. And we're delighted that he has consented to come and share with us on this significant day. That Sunday evening, with Sunday evening with the pastor, I will share the word of God for the people of God. On that day, we've asked our members to make a sacrificial offering as we celebrate the blessings God has given to us. And part of that offering will be used so that we can provide Thanksgiving baskets for the countless families who are looking forward to having Thanksgiving. And we want to be a blessing to them. So we'd ask you to sow into that ministry as we move forward. The second Sunday in November, Women's Day, and the Reverend Dr. Betty Wright Riggins will bring the word at our 9 a.m. service, and the Reverend Dr. Marilyn Turner Triplett will bring the word at 7 evening, Sunday evening with the pastor. So you can see a lot of wonderful things are taking place in the life of our congregation. Don't forget the census. The census had to be reported by September the 30th. That's this coming week. Make sure that you fill out the census. It's important because the dollar amount that goes to our community has a lot to do with how we respond. On the other hand, another critical matter, and that is to vote. Make sure you get your mail-in ballot. Make sure you're prepared to vote. I cannot say that enough, the importance of voting and the importance of making sure that your vote counts. So we have a lot to give God thanks for. These are some of the things taking place in the life of our church. This morning we were blessed to have an outdoor service, and we look forward to our next outdoor service on the second Sunday in October as God blesses us. So many things are happening, and we are grateful that God's given us the opportunity to engage in all those ministries. At the same time, this opportunity for us to make sure that as a church family, those names that you feel would be an added addition to our leadership of the church, you can submit their names so that we would be able to move them to our nominating committee. You can go online. If there's an individual that you prayed about, you feel as though in your heart they make a wonderful contribution to the life of this church as a deacon, a deaconess, or trustee, feel free to submit their name. Michelle Bradley will be interviewing those candidates, and we're looking forward to that. There's a lot of things going on, and I'm a member of the Blue Belt. What we say when we have something before us that's fired up and ready to go. So I pray that you're fired up, ready to do God's will, fired up, ready to make a difference in this world, fired up, making your voice count, fired up, making your vote count, fired up, letting God know that you appreciate all he's done for you, all he's doing for you. And with that said, we want to go to God in prayer. There's so many names on our sick and shut-in lists, but we know that God knows every name. We prayed today for the families. On Friday, we laid to rest one of our faithful members, Ann White. We've had a number of services. We want to keep Betty Smith, known to us as Cookie, and their family in prayer in the passing of her mother. We pray today for Deacon Leroy Conyers, one of God's faithful servants, for Deacon David Pennock. And the list of those names goes on and on and on. And so join us in your home as we bring before God our concerns, our petitions, our cares. Let God know that you know him and you know he's able and willing to bless and to heal and strengthen and to comfort. Our God can do all things and do all things well. Pray for this country of ours that's divided along racial lines. Ask God for healing. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and seek thy face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will heal the land. We need healing in the land. And we know God can bring that healing. So join me as we lift up the name of Jesus in prayer. As Dr. Jennifer Stewart leads us in your home right now, take a moment and look to God. Take a moment and talk to God. Take a moment and express to God your deep and genuine thanks. Talk to God in your home. Ask Him to continue to bless your home, bless your family, bless your neighbor, bless your enemies. Talk to God for a moment or two.
Most gracious and loving Father, Lord, we first come to you giving thanks. We thank you for new breath and new life on this morning, Lord, this evening. We thank you for being here in the midst, Lord. We thank you for your presence, God. And we thank you for being a healer and a comfort. We pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would touch and reach out to those that are sick and shut in, Lord. We pray that you would be a comfort to them and that you would be a healer. We pray for those that who have lost loved ones over these past several weeks, God. We pray that you would give them a peace that surpasses all understanding. We pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would touch them, their family members, their friends, and all those that are around them, God. We pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would touch each one of us in the circumstances that we are going through, Lord. We may not know of those circumstances, God, but we know that you know all things, that the hairs on our head are numbered, and that you care for us, God. We pray right now that you would be in the midst as the pastor or the messenger comes with the message, God. Fill him with the Holy Spirit, Lord, and provide the messenger with the word for the people. We pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, that we would be mindful to always give you all of the glory, all of the praise, and all of the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Join us as we give God thanks by simply saying amen, amen, and amen. Last week on our fireside chat, we had the opportunity to hear one of God's anointed servants, Dr. Asan Rodriguez. He talked about his journey moving from American Baptist Churches, where he served so faithfully, to being now the mayor of Collegeville. Stepped out on faith, not knowing exactly what was ahead, but trusting God. He serves in that position now with humility and commitment and passion. The reason I said that is because tonight we also have another man of God who stepped out on faith and did what the Lord inspired him to do. For a number of years, he's working for some mortician, some funeral homes. But God inspired him to step out and develop his own funeral home. He did not know how that was going to succeed, but he knew God. As a result of that, he is now the chief owner and operator of Beckett Brown and Hodges Funeral Home. He has done a tremendous ministry. It's not just a funeral home, but it's a place by which people can be ministered to in times of grief. I share that with you because Bethlehem, just like this world of ours, has some incredible people in the pews, but are willing to trust God and step out into deep water, not shallow water, but deep water, as a testimony to what God is able to do. There's no secret to what God can do. What God has done for these two will be a blessing that He will do for you. To trust God, to lean on God. So tonight we have the privilege and honor of hearing Reverend Keith Hodges, who was licensed in this church, ordained in this church, went to Palmer Seminary and to Lutheran Seminary and completed his work there. Serves this church in so many different ways, been a blessing to this pastor. And so we're delighted tonight that he's come, father, husband, servant of God. I pray tonight you receive him. But before he comes, Reverend Sean Tripland, our youth pastor, will bless us in song. And I want you to remember on Monday night, be sharing with us Monday Movement Service. And one of the things you will see as he sits at this organ and keyboard is that he is not confined to one aspect of ministry. Wherever he's needed, he serves as youth pastor, as helping this pastor, doing whatever is needed in the church. So let us hear now as he blesses us in song. And then the next voice you'll hear is the Reverend Keith Hodges, associate minister who served this church, assistant to the pastor, giving glory and honor to God. Pray for him as he brings to us the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Word, please. your word. Please order my steps in your word, Lord. Please order my steps in your word.
Thank you, my brother. Can you hear me okay? Good. I have a Father in heaven who I'm grateful for each day, simply to experience the breath of life that he has imposed into this humble body that stands before you now. I had an earthly father who transitioned from labor to reward after living graciously and lovingly for some 83 years. And now I'm left on this side of heaven with a spiritual father, and his name is the Reverend Charles Warren Quine, who I affectionately refer to as a brother pastor, a name given to him by a former deacon of this church some years ago that I have adopted as my own. I've adopted him as my own, and he has seen me through so many phases of my life when I believed that I could not even believe myself to be at the table. I couldn't understand why grace would be on my side and I would find myself in certain positions or vaulted or placed into certain spaces. He has moved me into some of them and certainly has encouraged me into many and has certainly been there by my side as I have been transformed into this man of less hair and grayer beard that stands before you now. And so anytime any of us has an opportunity to come and stand here at this altar, it is by his invitation. And I don't choose to come here without anything but a certain level of respect and reverence for him allowing me to do this. And I miss you all, too, here at the Bethlehem Church. I mentioned that I'm the steward of a gift that God has given me, and that is a funeral home in Philadelphia. I need you all to understand something and know something about where we are right now before I move into my sermon. I'm not going to be long before you, but we are going to be for just a little bit. The place where I occupy has been in existence since 1922, so just a little bit before the Depression era that many of your parents and possibly grandparents were victims of. As I stand here before you, the team that represents the Beckett Brown and Hodges Funeral Home now, we are the third iteration of its ownership. During our span of service and ministry, we have seen a number of different viral and bacterial conditions that we've had to deal with. Each of them, we take universal precautions to make sure that the families that we minister to are safe, the people that are coming to celebrate the life of someone who has transitioned are safe, and more than that, the village remain safe. We have dealt with HIV/AIDS, continue to deal with it. MRSA is something that comes through every now and then. During the Obama administration, there was something known as Ebola, which we've had to deal with. But in the span of our time, we have never, ever, ever seen anything like COVID-19. I declare that it's almost something that is both evil and divine in nature, which I'm going to unpack briefly. But certainly, it has forced us to be where we are today. With none of you before us in the pews this evening, when I walked in today, I was sure to give Dr. Jennifer and my brother, Reverend Tripline, and Pastor both a fist pump, an ankle kick, an elbow pump, and I also gave them a little Wakanda love because we are all staying safe and physically distanced from one another. So what I know is that whether it was 1922 or before that, or whether it was how we are today, the same God that was with us yesterday, he's with us this evening as we look to celebrate in prayer and word and worship. And while none of us knows what tomorrow holds, we sure do know, if you know what I know, who's holding tomorrow. And that is the God that we love. That is the God that we serve. That is the God that is still on the throne, somebody. And so with that, I want to move on into the text that Dr. Jennifer beautifully scripted out for us earlier. I'm going to put a little bit of a tag on it. She read it already, and so I'm just going to place a tag on it. My thought for this evening that I want to share with you is centered around three words from the English vocabulary or language, and they are order, disorder, and reorder. Let me say that one more time in the event that you might be scripting out a note or two. Order, disorder, and reorder. Eternal God, our Father, your word, it is indeed like a lamp unto our feet, and it's like a light to our path. I pray now that as I stand here, that somehow, some way, that it might be me who is moving out of this way, and that it might be you who would come and fill up this place. And we need you like never before. So let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Because, Lord, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. Amen. So, brothers and sisters, as we stand here this evening, already you would have come to know for sure, if you haven't already realized it, that we are living in some turbulent times. Every day we wake up, if I'm trying to go out about and having something of a good day, I choose not to turn on CNN, MSNBC, or any of my local television because I don't care to introduce that into my spirit when I'm trying to take care of people and minister to people. It ends up being a distraction to me being the positive force that I'm trying to be about in my day. But brothers and sisters, we're living through some things right now, things, quite frankly, that in my lifetime I've never seen before, much like what I said about COVID-19. As of this evening, you would have come to understand and know that as we waited patiently, moving beyond the civil settlement in the death of Breonna Taylor, which would have been awarded some $12 million to her family, as of this point on this evening, the police officers have been deemed not guilty. And after they executed a no-knock entry into the home, the wrong address of Breonna Taylor, fired some 20 bullets after her boyfriend felt like someone was breaking into the house, fired off a warning shot, killing Breonna Taylor. And so as of this evening, what we've come to understand that there will be once again no prosecution against a police force that somehow, some way executed something that in many of our eyes, and many of us who are marching in the streets, trying to help us all to understand that while all lives matter, it is something about 2020 where we're just trying to help us all understand that black lives matter as well. And black lives do matter. Someone said that it is a movement that is about us right now that is so profound and so big and so emphatic in terms of what it's doing on our planet right now. On our planet right now, that it is the most crucial, significant movement since the civil rights movement. Right now, we're in the midst of a global pandemic where each day we're seeing that the numbers continue to rise. And by the time we find ourselves in worship tonight, it's up over 200,000. I'm sure approaching some 210,000 souls that have been called on home to glory. One of them, too, being my mother in love. And two, we're dealing with a persistent, systematic racism that pits one side of the aisle versus the other side of the aisle, so much so that, as Pastor mentioned earlier, we find ourselves on the cusp of an election period that in my lifetime is one of the most critical, if not the most critical election for so many of us, where we are finding two different ideologies that are taking or desiring to take America down a certain path. And so as I stand here this evening, If you are someone who's not understanding that race is something that has intertwined itself into the very fabric of the United States of America in which we live, then you are either standing in your privilege or you are standing in denial this evening. And I need you to just understand that if I could just pose something for you a little bit. So seven police officers barge into the home of Breonna Taylor and are almost acquitted. In the same sense, if you don't believe that this is a race situation, there is a gentleman who walks into a church, and I dare say I use the word gentleman lightly. He walks into a church in Charleston, South Carolina, and shoots down and guns down 9 Bible study worshipers in a church in South Carolina. And is apprehended gently and softly, taken to a McDonald's or Wendy's so that he could get something to eat. If you don't believe that race isn't intertwined into our fabric, a man, Mr. Blake, is shot 7 times in his back. And the very next evening, a young white supremacist brandishes a rifle with the determination that he is going to protect the neighborhood that is not even his. He kills 2 of the protesters. He is apprehended gently and easily, given a bottle of water. And the president of these United States attorney is defending him in court. If you don't believe that race is intertwined into these United States of America, then you are either standing in your privilege or you're in denial. And you've got to understand, and I'm moving on into where it is that we're going to unpack this evening, is that all those of us who are in the pursuit of liberty, all of us who are in the pursuit of some sense of equality, are trying to demand is simply that we are allowed to some kind of order in our lives. That's all that we want. Ever since we were brought here some 401 years off of the west coast of Africa and landed in a place of Jamestown, Virginia, that is all that we have wanted, is some semblance of order in our lives. And if you don't look like me, if you're of the Caucasian race, that was your a goal as well when you departed the shores of England and Europe. That's all that you want. And when you came to these United States of America seeking liberty, so much so that you fought for it. And that's all that any of us want. That's all that a family bridging itself from Central America, moving through dangerous waters, traveling through the night, just to get here with their families so that they might be able to establish some kind of order in their lives. All of us want the same thing. We want our children to be able to grow up and have an equal education. We want them to be able to pursue their dreams, to become exactly who it is God created them to be. That's all we want. We want to see our grandchildren be able to take our legacies on to the very next step of what our family names are all about. We all want some kind of housing over our heads so that we can make sure that it's the key that we are putting on our door to enter into our own homes. And when we walk into our homes, all of us want to be able to sit down and have a meal together. All of us want to be able to wake up in the morning and go about a job and make a earning and make a living and be able to give back to society. That's all that we want, is a certain sense of order to our lives. And every time I believe that we've got a certain sense of order ready to be about our daily efforts and the lives that we're trying to build, every time I think that we are looking like we are on the cusp of something new or something great, I don't know about your life, but every time I think I got it all together, every time I think my children are all right, every time I think that this nation is all right, every time I think my neighborhood is good, without a doubt, invariably, something comes out of nowhere to completely disrupt the order that I'm trying to establish. Am I talking to anybody in here today? Am I right about it? Order is what we all want in our lives. But invariably, disorder comes from someplace, somewhere, out of nowhere. If you don't believe it, that is why we are in this sanctuary, just the 3 of us by ourselves this evening. is because of disorder. Because at the same time, around January the 1st of 2020, when I was declaring every New Year's resolution that I was going to make, and I was going to be more fit, I was going to be a better husband, I was going to treat my employees just a little bit better than I did in 2019, I was going to give a little bit more to my church family, I was going to make sure that the kingdom of God knew that I had passed this way. Just as I was getting ready for January 2020 for a new mountain to climb in my life, at the same time brewing in Wuhan, China, was a thing called COVID-19 or the novel coronavirus. And at the month of March, just when I was beginning to get myself together and settled into what I was going to do, out of nowhere came this complete shutdown of how it is that we're living. And if you don't know what disorder looks like, that is why we are in here by ourselves. This is what disorder looks like. When something introduces itself into the order of your life that you're trying to establish out of nowhere. And I need to just tell you three places where disorder comes from. And then I'm going to move on out your way. I need you to understand something. This is what the text does for us today. So anytime you open up your Bible, if I can just teach for just a moment. Anytime you open up your Bible for just a moment, and if you have this kind of redlining Bible, those are the actual words of Jesus Christ himself. And the text that was read beautifully by Dr. Jennifer opens up with Jesus saying to his disciples in this Gospel of John, the 12th chapter. He's saying to them, verily, verily, and note that too. Whenever Jesus Christ says, verily, verily, you better stop and listen, because he's about to drop something on you that you need to listen and be about. He says, verily, verily, unless a kernel of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much seed. You need to understand, if I can just give you a little bit of the context, is that Jesus was preparing his disciples, you and I, helping them to understand that he is about to fulfill the purpose for which he was created. He is about to go to the cross and die for you and for me. He's trying to help them to understand that listen, there was a certain amount of order that I had about my life as well. I was created so that I would come and not so much abolish the law that you had come to understand, but I have come to fulfill the law. Because you need to understand that in your genealogical history and in my genealogical history, at some point there was this thing called a fall from grace. There was a man named Adam who was in relationship with God, and God created people, and he created everything on this planet to be in relationship with it. And then when Adam disobeyed God and he ate of the fruit of the tree of knowledge, then what he did was he in rushed this thing called sin and in rushed this thing called death. And you need to know from your Bible that the wages of sin is death. And so from that point on, what God intended was to be in relationship with us, not only on this planet that he created, but beyond this planet and this heaven as well. But then this fall from grace happened. And then when your ancestral past, your genealogical history, when your family members died at some point, they remained down in the earth. Both the flesh and the soul remained down in the earth. Well, God at some point said, I've had enough of this. I've tried to direct you all to know that we need to be in relationship, but I am going to incarnate myself, he said, and I'm going to send myself back to you to show you how to live, to show you how to establish order, to show you how to love, to show you how to obey, to show you how to be faithful, to show you how to care not only for yourself and for me, but to care for the least of these. I'm going to show you. And then I'm going to give my only begotten son, that whosoever would believeth in him, you wouldn't perish, but you'd have everlasting life, somebody. And so that's what Jesus is saying. He's trying to say that, listen, I am a seed, and I'm going to be planted down into the earth, just like a seed, but this seed is going to do something different. It's going to take off its old nature, and when it takes off its old nature and lets go of itself and it actually dies, much more seed will be produced. In other words, Jesus Christ is saying, when I go to the cross and when I die and when I allow myself to be resurrected, in the time that I was here on earth, I affected this many people. The time on earth, you saw me do this with this many people. But I'm trying to tell you that when I die and when I have come back and you accept me as your personal Lord and Savior, you will be one of many more seeds who will go out from my one, and you will tell the world who I am, and you will be the blessing, and you will be the Great Commission. And people will come to know my love and the love of the Father through you. You will be the seed. And so the disorder that was introduced into the life of Jesus Christ himself was given to Jesus by God himself. Jesus experienced death, the disorder of death, given by God himself. And that's the first place you need to understand where disorder comes from sometimes. God himself. Well, watch this. You think that a lot of what you're dealing with that has come out of nowhere, you're not quite sure where it has come from, why it has come into your life. You need to know that it is God trying to shake you up out of your comfortable position that you have set yourself in. Let me see if I can tell you a story real quick. So in 2018, I was going about my life, and things seemed to be well. We were serving and worshiping here each Sunday, two services. Church was going well. I was a great husband, at least that's what I believed anyway. You can check with my wife and see if that's true or not. My son had graduated from high school. He was in his freshman year at Howard University. My daughter was playing basketball and doing great. Division I schools were looking at her. She was getting prepared to graduate and do her thing as well. And around November of 2018, I was at home by myself, and then the doctor's office called. Ring, ring, ring. Ring, ring, ring. I answered the phone, and it was my doctor, and she gives me this conversation. She says, Keith, so your blood work just came back, and cholesterol is a little high. You probably could get a little bit more iron in your diet, so I'm going to encourage you to eat a few more vegetables and get some fruits into your diet. She said, but Keith, I noticed something. There's a blood test called your PSA. And it checks the levels of the protein, amino acid that's in your bloodstream. And I need to tell you that yours has spiked a little bit from the last previous years when you and I have got together on your annual physical. And so I'm not wanting to alarm you right now, but I need you to go to your specialist and have him or her check it out a little bit more deeper. So I did those things. And lo and behold, by the time I finished out 2018, I had been confirmed with a diagnosis of prostate cancer. Out of nowhere, disorder. Out of nowhere. I was doing fine, and out of nowhere, disorder came into my life. And I wonder if anybody else knows what I'm talking about. You were just sitting back, going about your life, believing that you had gotten everything set up. And then out of nowhere, your wife said to you, I can't deal with you no more. I gotta go. Your children, which you have prayed over, grandmama and them have prayed over, did that thing that you asked them never, ever, ever to be about or ever to do. And now you got to get them a lawyer because they locked up. Oh, and then you get another telephone call and that you found out in your corporate America job that you fought to get at the table so much that now all of a sudden your department has been shut down and you are not being furloughed to be brought back. You have gotten a pink slip and then it's been encouraged that you take this package. Oh, and then I can go on and on and on. Only you know what kind of disorder you've been dealing with in your life. And sometimes it comes from God just to shake us up out of the comfort where we find ourselves. Because I mentioned to you earlier that this pandemic, it is both evil and it is both divine. There is a duality in this nature that you need to understand, because the evil of it is I can't understand why so many good people, some 200,000, had to die as a result of a casualty of this war that we're in. But then the divine part of it is what I need you to listen to. Because during this pandemic, you can tell me if you are honest or not, but God shut down everything.
We couldn't come to church. We couldn't go to restaurants. We couldn't go to movies. Just as we were getting ready for the NCAA March Madness season, that was shut down. The NBA Finals shut down. Schools shut down. Work shut down. God was saying to us that everything that you have been worshiping, I am taking away from you so that you are left with nothing but me and you and whatever's important to you. I'm shutting it down. And so during this pandemic, I wonder if you know that if you're the same way that you came into this thing as we come out of it, you have not taken advantage of the time that God has delivered unto you. Because I don't know about you, but I've been taking a little bit more time just spending in my Bible in the morning with a little bit of devotion. I wonder if that gift that God sowed into you when you were first created. And remember, this is one of my favorite sayings. Pablo Picasso helps us to understand that the meaning of life is to find out what your gift is. The purpose of life is to give it away. I wonder if before this pandemic, you were at somebody else's job and there's a gift that's sowed up in you that you need to be giving away. Maybe there's a small business that you need to get opened and to get at. Maybe there is a degree that you need to get to that you have been delaying, that you promised your mother and your father that you were going to finish high school and get your GED. Maybe there is a relationship that you need to go on ahead and move into, or there's a relationship that you need, in fact, to shut down, because there is no relationship that is ordained by God that is not helping you to become who you are supposed to be. So I'm wondering, in the divinity and the divine nature of this pandemic that is sent to us by God, because I don't know if you know this or not, but God, He is in everything. He's in everything, even this pandemic. I wonder if somebody who's under the sound of my voice needs to get at it. That's not good English, but it sounds good that way. If you need to get at it and get to what God created you to be. Oh, but then the second one, and I got one more that I'm going to be out your way. This second one, I need you to understand that some things do come from God. But yeah, the many times that you say that the devil made me do it, yeah, sometimes things come from the devil himself. Because if you remember in the book of Job, there is God standing over his creation. And then here is the devil just roaming about his creation, looking to kill, steal, and destroy. And so he goes to God and he says, God, you think everything is so good with your people. Why don't you just allow me to come at one of them and let me see what will happen? And God stands back and says, you try my servant Job. Don't you kill him, but you try my servant Job. I'm just going to remove my hedge and hand of protection off of him for a little bit, and then you go at it. And so Satan did. Took away his family, took away his livelihood, took away his money, took away his health, took away everything. But never in the course of the time that Satan was attacking Job did he curse the name of God. And in fact, what he came to the realization is, and we say this at funerals all the time, is that the Lord has giveth, the Lord hath taken away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. I wonder if there's anybody in here on today that knows that things have been snatched away from you during this time that we have been shut down. Things have been pulled away from you. There's been death in your family. There's been economic damage to your household. There has been turmoil in your thinking. Your mental capacity is down. Depression, anxiety is up. But I need somebody to stand up right now, and you better not ever curse the name of God, because he is still on the throne. You need to be reminded that while we can't quite see what this chaos is all about and what this struggle is all about, there is a thorn that is in your side right now. And like the Paul declared, please God, take this discomfort or disorder away from me. God said, I will not. Whatever it is that we're going through right now, it is meant to be a thorn in our side. Why? So that we can understand that there's that duality of nature again, that even though there's a thorn in our side, his grace is sufficient. So I know you're going through, but if you take a piece of paper right now, and if you on one side of the ledger lay out all of the blessings that God has bestowed upon you, and on the other side of the ledger you lay out all of the chaos and trouble that you're going through, I guarantee you, by the time you have finished the equation, once you have taken the subtrahend away from the minuend, then you will see that the equation is going to end up with the favor of God on your side. And then the last one. Some things do come from God himself to shake us up out of our comfort zone. Yeah, sometimes God and the devil have a conversation just about you. But you continue to bless the name of God and you just wait on him because all things work together for good to him who loved the Lord or her and are called according to his purpose. But then sometimes some of the dysfunction and the disorder in our lives didn't come from God. You cannot blame it on the devil. It came from you and me ourselves. Paul, the greatest preacher outside of Christ himself, declared this. He said, you know, I'm doing so much in the kingdom. But my greatest fear is that all that I'm doing for the kingdom of God, that I will do something that will diminish and obstruct and tear down all of the work that I'm doing because of a decision that I have made. Jerry Falwell, number of people, one decision tears down everything that you sought to build up because of one silly decision. You didn't have to go all the way. You needed to have moved out of that. You needed to have decided that is not good. You were the reason why you are where you are today. But I got good news for you is that there is order that you're trying to establish. There is disorder that comes from God, the devil himself, not without God. And then there are some things that come from you and me making some of the most ridiculous decisions that we have ever made. But the only thing that you need to know is that whether it comes from God or whether it comes from the devil and God in conversation or whether it comes from you, whenever disorder comes into your life, it is meant for you to begin to reorder. And I really like that. It is meant for you to reorder some of the things in your life. Remember what I said about that seed? Yeah, that seed needed to die. It didn't die a physical death not to produce anything anymore. What it did was it took off its old nature and it took on a new nature. And when it put on its new nature, that's when much seed was able to be produced. Thank you, Jesus. And so what I'm trying to say to somebody is the disorder that has been introduced into your life is meant for you to reorder some of the ways that you've been going about your life. It's time for you to let some things die. You need to let go of your attitude and how you receive and perceive and look at things that are coming your way. God doesn't send anything by way of a subtraction to shut you down. He adds things to your life. It's all about how you look at it. Yeah. You need to reorder your thinking around the relationship that you've been in. You need to reorder your thinking about your gifting that you need to give back to the kingdom that God is looking for you to be a blessing in. You need to reorder your thinking about your job affiliations. You need to reorder some things. Maybe even sowing some things into your body that you need to stop because this is the temple of God. Only thing I'm trying to tell somebody on today is that I know you feel like you're struggling. But all God is saying, just like he did in the book of James, when chaos and troubles come your way, dear brothers and sisters, count it all joy. Count it all joy, the cancer. Count it all joy, the loss of a job. Count it all joy, this pandemic. Count it all joy. Because when God throws something your way by way of any form of disorder, it is simply a time for you to understand that he is in your neighborhood and he's trying to reorder the way you've been living and the way you've been going about this thing on this side of heaven. And so I close with this. Disorder that we're always trying to establish. Disorder is going to come from one of those three sources. And then you need to reorder your life in order to fit into what God has for you. And I need somebody on today to stand up and reorder first and understand that God created you to be something great. And when you begin to let some things die, he will fill himself up with his glory and his grace and will move you at light speed to where you're supposed to be. And on this day, you need to stand with confidence and knowing that someday each of us is going to receive a disorder that does not look like a few of the things that I mentioned. That it, in fact, will be the disorder of death. But death is not the end of the story. If you do this on today, this is the greatest reordering that you could ever do of your flesh and your life. You could accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. When you do that, he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him, you would not perish, you'd have everlasting life. I need you to reorder your life with an acceptance of Jesus Christ as the Lordship of your life. And when you do that, doesn't matter the disorder that you have to go through. When you finally receive the disorder of death, when God sends his pale white horse down death to receive your soul, you will meet God in an appointment. And God, all he wants to hear is that you've got your John 3:16 with you. And if you do, you'll hear these words. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. I know you were trying to garner a certain level of order in your life. Disorder came from everywhere. But know that I was always with you. And the reordering of your mouth and your belief that Jesus Christ, my son, came. He died. He resurrected. He was your redeemer. He's coming back again. And he received you unto himself and brought you to me. When you hear that, he will say, enter ye into the gates of heaven. Well done. Order, disorder. It's time to reorder somebody. Do it today. Watch your life be different. Even when things around us don't look well. God is still on the throne. He loved you first. That's why you should love him. Amen.
On the heels of this moving and powerful word, you have the opportunity to reorder your life. Order my steps. Order my steps. Yes. Order. Disorder, reorder. So tonight you can begin anew. No matter what your life has been, no matter what disorder you have in your life, tonight you can give yourself to Christ. And he can turn your life all the way around. He can give you a new heart, a new mind, a new way of thinking, a new way of living. Change your priorities. We would love to have you become part of this place called Bethlehem, the House of Bread. But there's a church for everyone. So I pray now, as you hear my voice, you will hear the voice of God speaking to you. Now is the time to reorder your life, to get your life together. God has given you this chance, this opportunity. The invitation is extended. Whosoever will, let them come. Man, woman, boy, or girl. Come on. We are a church that's deeply committed to inclusion and diversity. Doesn't matter what your ethnicity, doesn't matter where you live, doesn't matter where you come from. We serve a God who loves us all. Hallelujah. And so I would extend to you this evening the greatest invitation of your life. Yeah. That you might come and find order in spite of disorder. Yeah. And then come and have your life reordered.
Thank you.
So I pray tonight he's done that for me. I know he'll do that for you.
Yes.
Man, woman, boy, or girl, tonight. Call the church, 215-643-4977. We'd love to hear from you.
Yes.
We thank God that he has touched our lives. We're not what we used to be, but we thank God we're not anywhere near where God wants us to be. He's still working on us.
Thank you.
Taking that disorder and changing it into order. So we serve him tonight. We praise him tonight. Won't you take this opportunity to call the church once again, 215-643-4977. We thank God for how God is using him and blessing him in spite of all he's been through. He's preaching like he knows exactly what God's able to do.
That's right.
And so tonight, May your life be a life that lived like you know what to do in giving your life to Christ. We pray tonight you've been blessed by the word, blessed by the presence of God, and we pray again that we hear from you. Send us a note, a word that lets us know you appreciate this Sunday evening with the pastor. Yes. Next Sunday evening, one of our sons in the ministry, also Reverend Walker Keith Thompson, will bring the word. Every Sunday evening, we invite you to join us and invite somebody to come that their hearts might be lifted as we share the love of God with the people of God. It's been a good day.
Yes, sir.
Make it a great night. Go to bed tonight and say, Lord, I want to accept the opportunity to come to you and have my life be ordered. Mm. It's amazing what God will do when you give your life to him. Thank you once again. God bless you. God keep you. Gracious God, we thank you for this night, for the word that we've heard from your servant, for the song of praise, for the reading of the word, and just for your presence in this sanctuary. We know, God, that even though the pews are empty, that you're here. We felt it.
Yes.
We knew it, and we're better as a result of it. So for that, we give you thanks. Be in our homes. Be with our families. And be with us, oh God, every day of our lives, that we will know that you're ordering our steps each and every day. In the name of Jesus Christ do we pray. Amen and amen. Have a good night. Make the day tomorrow even better. To God be the glory.